Happy New Year! I feel like that's what was about to happen. What's up, everybody? We're on part two of the gratitude challenge tonight, which is we have a whole new flock in here, and I'm super excited. I feel like I know them all. Just in case anybody's watching this and they happen to stumble onto this thing and they have no idea what they're doing, I'm Theo. You might have seen me in a Mary-Kate and Ashley movie many years ago. This is kind of cool. We started this thing, Go Get It Life, just like literally out of nowhere. And we wanted to do something cool this year. And all the people you're seeing are basically kind of like the people who started it with us, because the Gratitude Challenge was the first big thing we did, and their stories and everything they did is just part of what we're trying to do over there every day, which is just motivational stories for yourself, for others, helping yourself, which is extremely important in this life, because in helping yourself, you also turn around and help others, which is a lot of people's stories who are on this. And Go Get It Life is just kind of like a place where you just go and could read cool stories and share your own, more importantly, because we all know that, when you say some things, it's the butterfly effect. The right person reads it, one person reads it, and a million things happen. So, welcome. I'm going to go and introduce everybody, and I'm going to start right to my left with my man Phil, who I just watched his video again today, and I'm going to let him tell you kind of his story and what he did for the Gratitude Challenge for Go Get It Life, and just a little about himself, and then him and I are going to do some questions. And before we do that, I did, in case anybody missed it, I just did the whole, I know a lot of people wanted to know about 122780. That was on Juice's head, and I just said that, and we'll refer back to that later if anybody missed it. So, Phil, what's up?
What's up, man? How are you?
I'm good, brother. I'm good. It's really good to see you and your family and everybody. And like I
Absolutely.
said, I just watched your video, and I just want you to explain to everybody just kind of your deal and your story and kind of what you did for yourself and for everybody else, and what you continue to do. I just think it's really cool.
Absolutely, man. First off, Jerry Gravino from the old Wolcott Avenue Boys said hello.
Man, he's down there DJing. Wow, I didn't know you know him.
He's still around, man. He's still around.
Wow, you tell Jerry knew me when. Yeah, when I was a very different person, and him and I lived a very fast, crazy life back
He
in the
showed me
day.
a few pictures that we'll keep between you and I and him and Wolcott Avenue.
Oh man, Phil, that is amazing. That is great. I love Griver, and yeah, he left us a long time ago to go out there. And occasionally, I'm not on. Well, I am on Facebook, but I really just go on quick and kind of get off. And I always seem to see a picture with him with like headphones on or something. So I don't know. Yeah.
Well, he's in good hands, man. He says hi, and
Yeah.
he still loves you like your brother. So,
That's awesome, man. Thank you. That's so cool.
yeah. But
So tell everybody what's up.
basically, about 8 or 9 years ago, I was not a very good person. I got myself into some bad things. I was living the lifestyle, DJing and hustling, and doing all that stuff, and kind of lost everything, man. And I wanted to make a change in my life. And I always grew up surfing and decided that it was time to really put something back towards the community. So along with my beautiful wife and my children supporting me, we started a Surf Dreams Foundation. And we have now helped over 200 kids get into the sport of surfing. And we just provided Christmas for six local children in the Myrtle Beach, South Carolina area with amazing Christmas gifts. And so that they didn't do without. And it's just that's kind of the cliff notes of everything. It can happen. I was a meth addict. The recovery rate for meth is 9%. And I've been 9 years clean. I beat it. And there's a lot of people out there going through struggles and going through tough times that they can beat it too. And my door is always open for anybody who wants to talk. And anybody who wants to get something off their chest and maybe change their life. So that's what we're doing with Surf Dreams. We're just kind of giving every kid a chance to do something good in life. And change a life.
Where can people find out about it, Phil? Just, you know, if they want more info on it, people are in, you know, South Carolina or wherever, you know, in the local area, kind of want to know, where is it?
What, it's like, what's it? SurfDreamsFoundation.org is the site you go to. Awesome. And we're hopefully in 2015. January 17th, we're 1 year old. Okay, we're brand new. We raised almost $12,000 last year. We're currently raising money to get a passenger van so we can drive up and down the East Coast and spread the love from New York to Florida. So, you know, we want to do that, and that's kind of our goal this year. So SurfDreamsFoundation.org, get involved, and maybe we'll get Mr. Theo Rossi out there surfing one day.
Yeah, I tried to surf once when I was in Mexico, actually doing that amazing Olsen Twin movie I did. And that, you know, I that was the last time. Oh, no, that's not true. I did try in South America as well, and I think I tried in somewhere else I was. Who knows? This was the day. It was somewhere else, and I tried. And you know what? I'm like a crazy, like, perfectionist. It was like, oh, I wasn't great in the beginning, so I stopped. But now I'm such a different person that I would actually love it more than anything. So I might take you up on that offer. Absolutely. But let me tell you, man, you know, the reason the story I did an independent film a couple of years ago called Meth Head, and I did you know, a lot of research on meth, and I've had a lot of tragedies in my life, immediate family, and you know, just a lot of stuff to do, you know, drug related and things like that. And when I got into you know, really researching meth, you know, a big epidemic here in New York is heroin. It's a huge deal, right? Big in Staten Island, big everywhere, in the East Coast, and meth was foreign to me. You know, when I went to LA, was the first time I'd really been exposed to kind of that whole culture of it. And when I did the real research on it, the numbers were outstanding, because you always hear about other ones and you didn't hear about meth and the right. things like that. So I'll tell you this, man, that getting that, you know, that monkey on your back and fighting that and all that is it's a tremendous thing, and the gratitude you've shown from what you've been able to do with yourself is super motivating to me, and what you continue to do for people. So I have no doubt, you know, with all the surfing stuff, with your incredible family, with your incredible wife, like, you know, you're just gonna keep doing everything, and it really is inspiring. Like I said, I watched that video again just because what I love for me is, I just, you know, I've always said, more than anything, like, interesting stories to me are, you know, when people do great things and do things, but what's really interesting to me is, like, comeback stories. Like, I've always loved that, and I love people that, you know, help themselves and in turn help others. So I thank you for that, man, and I thank you for motivating and being a voice for that now through Go Get It Life, that if people want to contact you through the blog and comment on it like that, you know, people that are going through it, that's an amazing thing.
Absolutely, man. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. We're here to help, you know. We want to make people better. We want to get people help, and just people who want to talk, especially kids nowadays, because there's not a lot of outlets for kids, you know, with the video games and movies and things like that. Just kids really need to find something that they are passionate about. And yeah. If you have passion, like you with Staten Strong and the boot thing, you know, like it's really big, and we want to try to teach that to our youth. You know, that's why I get my kids involved, because I want them to know that giving back's a good thing, and you want to teach people that you can be somebody no matter what. Your back might be against the wall, but eventually you can be somebody if you just stick your mind to it and just do you, stay in your lane, and make sure that you and your family are taken care of, and then after that, you want to help others and just, you know, try to change lives, and that's what we want to do.
And you're an example, man, and that's, you know, that's kind of the whole deal, right? Like, you know, for us, it's like I try to carry myself every day, because, you know, I've always lived my life by, like, little things that I hear, and one of them was always, like, people always say to me, like, you know, we were out shopping the other day, and, you know, it's great, because, you know, a lot of people, you know, they want to take pictures, and they come up, and you know, everybody, it's funny, you'll see people come up, and they'll always be like, this must suck for you, and I'm like, what are you talking about? Yeah. This is, like, the greatest thing in the world. I mean, this beats the alternative. I mean,
right, yeah, absolutely.
It's just, you know, I'd rather people, you know, come and take pictures and have a smile and they're crying and they're laughing and they're having the greatest time than coming up and punching me in the face. This is amazing. Right. So, yeah. So what I thought was, you know, was great for us is like when to see people come up. And so what I said is one of the quotes I've always lived by when people say, why are you always, you know, why are you always so happy? Why are you always, you know, working so hard? Why are you always this? And it's that Joe DiMaggio quote that, you know, somebody said to him, why do you run so hard to first every single time you get, you know, you get a hit, whether it be, you know, a small, you know, shallow inline, you know, or even a fly ball that you know they can catch. Why are you always running so hard? And he said, and they said, why do you play so hard? He said, because somebody in the stand, in the stands might be watching me and seeing me play for the first and only time. Right. And I've always thought that, you know, who am I? Like, you know, I'm in a crazy business. It's probably why I live in, you know, Staten Island and I kind of hole up with my, you know, my beautiful family and everybody around me is because, you know, the truth is, and I know every business is like this. There's a lot of the world is now pointed about, you know, you. This is a world where it's a you thing, and we're trying to make it like we. So I think everything you do is great. Give me a question. What do you got? Anything.
Like, how'd you get started with Staten Strong, and what motivated you to get started with that?
Totally. Great question. Staten Strong is one of those things where, you know, much like Go Get It Life, I believe my ignorance is kind of what always has kind of propelled me forward, is I was, it was after season 5, and I always come home. When the season ends, I always, at this point, I was living more in L.A. than I was in New York. And right. I always came to New York the second the season ended. And I happened to come, and it was, you know, around Thanksgiving, there was all these, it was the season that just ended, season 5. It was this crazy season for Juice, you know, right, ever since season 4. And then the storm was coming, and they said, you're going to have to move your flight up to come home. And I really wanted to stay for a Sunday dinner with my family, you know. And I was like, I got to stay, change my flight to Monday. And they're like, you might not fly out. This storm is going to be really bad. And I said, I don't care. I want to stay. And I stayed. And it hit, you know, right in my entire neighborhood. I think we were 1.6 miles from the epicenter of the whole thing. Staten Island was the worst hit area. It destroyed everything, and when I went out in the morning, it was like I was in a Michael Bay movie. I had never seen something like that. You know, I didn't know what was going on. I was like, this is crazy. And all of a sudden, I saw something that I'd never seen. I saw people who, you know, want to kill each other when you cut them off in a car, or want to fight if you, you know, if you're not moving fast enough in New York City. But all of a sudden, everybody came together, and I used social media, and I used, you know, any connections I had with the boot campaign and all that to kind of start making people, you know, do this hashtag Staten Strong. And we brought, you know, socks, and every people were stuck in their basements. We were clearing out water. We were just doing everything. And I watched all this whole community came together. And from then on in, we formed Staten Strong. We rebuilt, you know, I think 5 houses and passed out, you know, tons and tons of money in gift cards, and still do kind of, you know, things that we can.
It's still kind of crazy up there.
Yeah, it's still crazy.
One of my directors with the Atlantic Surfing Federation, he lives in Long Island, and, you know, he's still trying to recover. And one thing as surfers as we did was we had a 31-foot U-Haul go from Florida to New York, and it stopped in different stops along I-95, and people like myself would bring items, blankets, clothes, food, non-perishables, out to 95, and we would put it in this truck and send it up there. Yeah. And because a lot of the surfing community was affected, you know. The things that we saw just by pictures and videos, living on the coast, I could only imagine, you know, what the people
there were. It was one of the, you know, more rewarding. We had amazing things with, you know, all the people who got involved, from DeMarco Murray to Cowboys, Chris Weidman to everybody. So it was really great. And Staten Strong will always be something that, you know, is incredibly close to my heart. And again, that we're still, you know, we have meetings and we're still kind of doing stuff. So Phil, you're amazing. You're the best. I'm tremendously motivated by you, and your family's incredible. And I know we'll talk through Go Get It Life and probably one of these again soon. So tell Griv I said what's up. I'm going to move on to Keeley. Keeley, you're late for class. What's going on?
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good.
What's going on in LA?
It's been great, I'll tell you. You know, I think the number one thing about living in a city like LA, and you're surrounded by so much wealth, and it's amazing because I feel like there's really no middle class anymore in America.
Yeah,
that's true. There just isn't. I was raised in one, but they've all kind of dissolved, and I feel like it's a great place to put myself to use, because I feel like, you know, I work for a great organization, but, you know, they're all run by millionaires. So mm-hmm. I tend to be the voice of reason out here, because people say, oh, you know, it's I mean, there's definitely a lot of beauty, and there's the business and Hollywood and all these fun things, but I think the number one thing that I see so much is poverty.
Mm-hmm.
And there's so much of it that people are so used to walking by it, and it's a part of their life. And they're really part of our community. So I just want to commend you on what you've done with Staten Strong and really shedding a light on these charities, because I think that, you know, something bad happens, there's a shooting, there's a disaster, there's earthquakes and things, and it's on the news for 2 days, and then it's forgotten. And yet the need is still there every day.
Yeah, and you know, listen, we can go on, all of us, forever. I mean, it's kind of one of the things.
Yeah.
That's why, you know, me personally, I don't, you know, I made a choice a long time ago not to read the news or watch the news. You know,
yeah.
I say if it's a big enough deal, somebody's going to knock on my door, or they're just going to tell me, or I'm going to see it somewhere, whether it be on social media or something. I just don't. Because the truth is, it just all happens so fast, and
yeah.
it's always a really big deal, and then, you know, it goes away. And for the groups that I work with, you know, from the Humane Society to the Boot Campaign, this stuff that, you know, we've just been working on for years and years, that's a hot-button topic for a second, and then it just kind of goes by. Keeley, tell everybody your story for Go Get It Life, your gratitude challenge.
Thank you. So for my gratitude challenge, I wrote a very long entry. Sorry for the novel. There's a couple volumes, I think. But, you know, I really, my guardian angel is my father. He was a Vietnam vet, and he was exposed to a lot of radiation in the war. And when he came out of that, he ended up with Hodgkin's disease in the 70s before I was even born, and he had a lot of medical problems throughout his life. But one of the things that he always did was volunteer, and he, you know, he was an architect, but one of the things he would do when he had a lot of heart problems is his way to kind of pull himself through was to go and help someone else. That would make him feel better. And one of the things that we would do is on holidays, we would go down to Skid Row in downtown LA, and we would go work in the soup kitchens together. We did AIDS race together, and his real thing was, I'm not always going to be here. And when that day comes, you have to continue this work. It's not about if you have a partner to do it. You have to continue this because the need's always going to be there. So he got really ill in March of 2007 and ended up in the ICU. And the rest of my family really couldn't deal with it. Oh, my God, I'm going to get emotional. They couldn't really deal with it. So it was just him and me. And those last 2 weeks when he was alive, I said, okay, you're going to tell me all these things you want me to do. And so really how I carry on his legacy is every weekend, every holiday, every chance I get, I typically will put at least 2 or 3 days aside a week, and I have different nonprofits that I work with. One of the ones that I love is called Beauty Bus, and we go into the homes of chronically and terminally ill patients, and we give them free beauty treatments and one-on-one attention. And yeah, so that's one of the ones I've been involved in for about 5 years. Another one is Gobble Gobble Give. On Christmas, Easter Sunday, and also Thanksgiving, we find a different business that will give us their venue for free. And we have everyone bring in food from Trader Joe's, Whole Foods, wherever, you know, you can. And we put together hot meals and clothing, donated clothing from all over the city. And we drive around these hot meals and clothes to every single homeless person we can find from 8 o'clock in the morning till the, you know, 8 o'clock at night. It's a full day, and that's amazing. And I one of the things that I found when we did it this year was so many veterans. There's mm-hmm. so many veterans mm-hmm. that are living on our streets here,
yeah, especially in California.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah.
That's
the stuff that what you you know, we were just talking about this morning, you know, Megan and I, and you know, we go walk the dogs every morning, and we walk them like it's like 9 degrees, and we're walking, and you know, it's like, you know, we always walk on this like mile and a half walk early in the morning, and we were talking about like how, you know, leaving your legacy, right, for other people, like that's all you could really ask for. You know, sometimes I think that a lot of people get so, you know, I say I'm not scared of anything in this world except for like death. I don't know why. Maybe it's because I just don't know, you know, what it is. And I think the easiest way, you know, to get over fear is, you know, by facing it. So, you know, I remember I wasn't too keen on jumping out of a plane, and the next thing you know, Opie had me jumping out of a plane. So now it's like, oh, okay, that wasn't the worst thing ever. I'll never do it again, but I was like, oh, that wasn't the worst thing ever. But the thing is, it's like, you know, about leaving your legacy, and I think that that's what your dad did, and that to me is the easiest way to kind of face whatever is going to happen. You know, it's leaving your legacy, whether that be to friends, family, children, whatever it is down the line, to continue what you set up, you know, and that was the perfect example of it. So I really thought that was it's such a touching story to me, because it's exactly what I'm trying to do and I hope to do. So, you know, wherever your father is, I say thank you, and I think whatever you do is everything you do, because I know all about that stuff. You know, again, being in and out of L.A. for 13 years, you know, and like I said, I'll be back there next week, I know all about what goes down. You know, I stay downtown when I come there, so I know all about the different organizations and Thanksgiving and, you know, how it is down at Skid Row and, you know, Sons. We filmed a ton down there. So we see the have and the have-nots, and it's a huge polar thing in L.A. and everywhere else right now at this point. So thank you. So give me a question. What do you got, Keely? What do you got?
I got no pressure. I was wondering what motivates you? What motivates you?
That's a great question. What motivates me? Everything. But to keep it short, nobody in this world is ever going to ask more for me than I'm going to ask of myself. I constantly am trying to be better than the person I was yesterday, every single day. And I am at war with myself at all times. I am probably, I don't ever feel like I'm doing enough, ever. I move fast, really. I move past things very fast, meaning that, you know, what people, a lot of people think is a huge deal, I think it's great, and then I keep going, because I feel like I want to be exhausted when I leave this place. I want to be exhausted. And I'm trying to, you know, exhaust myself. I'm trying to do everything. I have no interest in sitting around. I have no interest I don't get caught up in the madness of everything. I don't go to clubs, and I don't do any of that stuff. I don't care for the madness that kind of comes with the business and all that. I love to act, and one of the main reasons I love to act and produce is because this is the greatest platform I can use to help people. It's just the way the world is set up, you know. So I felt that with this job I can hopefully change the world a little. I can affect the most people by whatever that is, you know. That's why when people say, you know, don't you despise social media and all that? And I say, if you look at it like that, I don't look at social media for the ridiculousness that goes on. I look at it for, there's a lot of people that have a lot of voices. They can make a lot of changes and help a lot of people. So I just want to be exhausted. So what motivates me is you guys, is that there are people doing things. I get so impressed by people. I see what people do, like everybody here. I've watched every video, Kayla's and Phil's and Heather's and everybody's stuff and Barb, and I watch this stuff and I never want to sleep, and that's why I probably should sleep. I don't really sleep. I don't really like it. I'm not a fan of sleeping. That's my mortal enemy is sleeping. So thanks so much, Keely. I think you're great. I'll be in that sunny weather of LA soon, and I'm going to... You know, we, and also another thing I didn't say on the last one, You guys all have some really cool stuff coming to you, by the way. That's why Megan's been probably harassing you about addresses. I have so much stuff from the show and from other things, and I just think it's really cool. Some of the stuff you guys are gonna get some really cool stuff, and I didn't tell the last group of amazing Go Get It Life people that they're doing that. So thank you, and Kayla, what's up?
Hi.
How are you?
Good, excited.
Yeah, your video was fantastic.
Yeah. Thank you. Do you like that?
I did. It was really funny. Your timing was perfect. Everything was great. It was your dogs are obviously your dog is incredible, and all the dogs you saw, and you know, man, mine are all surrounding me right now. They're all staring at me. They're wondering why they didn't go on their walk. They all just went out in the backyard, and they're not happy about it. So tell everybody what's up. Tell everybody what you did.
Well, after I found out about the challenge, I went searching everywhere to see what I wanted to do to give back. And while searching, I found out about the Speranza Animal Rescue. And when I found out that they not only rescue dogs from kill shelters, they take in dogs that have been hit by cars. Recently, they just took in a mastiff that had been hit by a car, paid for all the vet bills for it to get well, nursed it back to health, and they made it available to be adopted again. They give all dogs second chances. So whenever I found out about that, I knew that was exactly what I wanted to spend my energy on. So I hit the ground running with fundraisers and bake sales. I went around asking people for donations. I still get donations from people at work, which is amazing. We went up, we gave them dog food, we gave them all the donations. We got to meet the dogs. Actually, the very first four dogs that you see in that video, they've all been adopted since then. How cool is that?
Good job.
It's been awesome.
Yeah, and you just went right into action. I think what was really the coolest thing for me to see was, like, you know, seeing how you just went into action. And that's kind of what it's about, right? You know, half the battle is actually getting up and doing something. You know, we all think we want to do things. And Kayla, who's behind you, by the way?
What? Hold on, I lost you. Found you.
Technical difficulties. Yeah. Super good.
Kayla, who's your friend behind you?
Oh, that's my friend Arielle. She's the one that actually told me about Speranza, so I felt like.
Of course. What's up, Arielle? How are you? Frozen. That's what's happening. Frozen. We lost her. Kayla, we lost you. We're moving. We're moving to Heather. We're coming back to you, Kayla.
Hi.
Hey, how are you? Oh, we missed. Who did we miss? We missed Jackie. Heather, stay right there.
Okay.
Jackie.
Hi, Theo. How are you?
I'm good. What's up? We're going to come back to Kayla. If Kayla could hear us, we're going to come back. Her camera froze. How are you, Jack?
Good. How are you?
I'm good. I'm alive, so that's the first step. So that's a good thing.
Hearing you talk about the cold weather that you're having there.
Yeah, you can't say anything.
Cold weather and rain?
Right.
Where are you in Canada,
by the way? You know I'm basically half Canadian at this point, from Kim Coates taking me everywhere in Canada.
Yes. I'd like to challenge you and Kim to visit Labrador.
Labrador? Where is that? Tell me what it's near.
It is way over on the coast of Canada. It's up north, so we have two seasons here in Labrador City. Right here tonight, our temperature is minus 45.
Minus 45.
Yes.
It's a little cold. I don't know if you know. I don't know if you're informed of that. I actually think you should evacuate. Is there a possible way?
Come and try it. It's really cool.
Out of there. Minus 45.
We don't surf here, Bill.
At that point, that's bad news. No, I think that you're 10 times tougher than I am. And I was complaining about a little rain, And I got to tell you, it rained for like an hour and a half today. And I'm a mess. But, let me tell you something. With a name like Labrador and being Canada, which I love, by the way, good for you. What's the hottest it gets? Like 3? What does it get? Is that when everybody wears?
No, we get 2 months of warm weather. We might get it like in the plus 30s maybe, but it's normally generally, we get like 6 months of winter.
Yes, 6 months. That's good. Yeah. So nobody's riding motorcycles around there. It's kind of like it's snowmobiles.
Yeah, that's what it is. You need to come and do a snowmobile.
Sons of Anarchy snowmobile thing. Like we'll all be on snow.
Yeah. Here's cool. A new challenge for Kurt Sutter.
Here it is. So yeah, it'll be like a winter special.
We'll
do a prequel on snowmobiles. I like that. Tell everybody what's up, Jackie. Tell everybody kind of what you did and your gratitude challenge and all that.
Okay, I currently live in a community where we are a mining community. Yes. So with the price of iron ore has dropped, our economy is pretty much gone. The price of ore has dropped. We've had one mine shut down. We have another mine making a lot of cutbacks. So we got a lot of people without jobs right now. So it's pretty bleak here right now. We got a lot of sad people walking around. It's really hard here right now, and you don't see a lot of people smiling here. So what I did as a part of my challenge was I tried to get people to smile more. So as I'm out around the store, I'd see somebody, anybody at all that looked my way, I'd give them the biggest smile that they would ever see.
Yep.
It made me feel pretty good, and I guess from what I was getting back from them, it was making them feel pretty good too. So that was my part of the challenge.
And the reason I thought that was truly like the coolest thing in the world for me, because I was talking about it on the last challenge, was sometimes everybody, you know, a lot of reasons why people don't go into action is because they think that things are so massive. They're like, well, if I'm not going to solve all the world's problems, I'm not going to do anything. And what they don't realize is that's just not the way it goes. You know what I mean? You have to start with this and then the butterfly effect, right? We talked about that earlier. That's how it happens. The one person who you helped might help, and maybe that person down the line is the person that's going to do whatever it is. And it's not about who does it, it's just like getting it done. So for me, it's like I try to do the same thing, right? You know, I come, you know, I'm in a business, and, you know, like I said, I was a very different person before I started this life that I'm in. And it was a different kind of life where, you know, you never smile. And the harder you were and the, you know, the way you were and the, you know, that was kind of, and we're in a culture where that's kind of like what it is, right? So you got all these, you know, every guy, you know, in this business, you know, wants to fancy themselves the next Marlon Brando, and they want to, like, you know, grunt and talk low and smoke cigarettes and, you know, I don't know what they're doing half the time. And the thing is that nobody ever really, you know, kind of smiles and is happy, and like that's kind of like almost like a weird thing nowadays, and I find that so odd. I don't really understand the point of that. So I thought that it was so great because that's kind of just what I try to do. Most of the times you see me, I'm smiling like an idiot, but it's truly because I genuinely know that I'm just kind of happy, because who knows how long I have left. I don't want to go out miserable. I thought it was really awesome, and I just think that it was just such a perfect story for you can do anything. The littlest thing is the most important. So thank you. What's your question?
My question is, if you can eat pie with anyone without the same outcome as Juice had,
past or present,
who would it be and why?
Great question, by the way. We're definitely eating pie, so now I got to think who I don't mind seeing eating, because then if it's someone weird, because then I'm actually having a conversation with them, right, because they're eating pie too. I would say past or present, if I could eat pie with anyone. Oh, God. I mean, you know, one of the biggest influences in my life, you know, was my uncle, who passed away in 2004. And he kind of taught me everything of who I am and how I am, and really laid the groundwork for all of it. Tremendous, tremendous human being who I think about constantly. And he kind of took the place, you know, my dad left when I was younger, and he kind of, you know, moved into that spot, and just a really great guy. And it would probably be him. I'd like to know what he thinks about all this. You know, it was 10 years ago. It was kind of before this life kind of took control, and we'd always joke around about it. Because it was, you know, I didn't start acting, you know, I started pretty late in the game.
Do you think you'd be proud where you are?
Oh, yeah. I think, Jesus. Yeah, I think that I know he is, and I know he would be. And I think that he would tell me to keep going.
That's awesome.
I think he would say you can do so much more. So, you know, for me, I'm one of those people, like, I don't feel like I've done anything in anything, because that's my mindset. You know, I just keep going, and I'm going to keep going.
So, you obviously do things. I mean, this challenge has gotten you a lot of response.
Oh, yeah, it's been amazing.
15 of us picked as winners. I mean, that was only a small portion of what you had submitted. So yeah. I think that's fantastic. Keep it up. You Thank need to keep you. It up.
I'm going to, and thank you so much, and keep smiling, and do yourself a favor, wear like a North Face or something. Heather, how are you, Heather?
I'm doing well, how are you? I'm
fantastic, it's so great to see you.
Nice to see you too.
How's everything?
Everything is going great, can't really complain besides the weather.
Yeah, you're in
here. Even that, I can't complain about after hearing her story.
None of us can, Heather. I mean, you know, where are you? You're in Maryland, right? I got abandoned in me and my buddies broke down and got stuck in a snowstorm in Aberdeen, Maryland.
Okay. I live right outside of Baltimore.
Yeah, I think Nirvana's from there. We got stuck there. We were visiting a school, Catholic University, up there back during college days. We were getting recruited for football. And then one of my buddies, one of my best friends, left the school. We were in Albany, and he went to Maryland.
Oh, okay.
I just always remember they had the Michigan uniforms. So tell everybody, Heather, what you did and what's going on.
Well, basically, probably a year or so ago, I really felt like I noticed that a lot of people around me were viewing life in a negative way, and I just really didn't want to go down that path, so I started to think more positively. I made a promise to myself that I wouldn't allow something to upset me for more than a day, and then I would move past it, and I think that kind of translated into my fitness. Because back in June, I decided to commit myself to 5 days a week at a boot camp and really have fun with it. And it continued on to now. And even through an injury on my foot, I've still managed to have success and not let that stop me.
And what you have to understand is that to me, and the reason why it was so important to me is I'm... Like for me, I run every single day. I work out every day, and mainly because, you know, for me it's like my therapy, right? Like it's my deal. It's kind of the way I get to, you know, in a kind of chaotic world, I get to kind of, you know, be alone and kind of be with my thing and do my thing. And you know, it's more for me than it is for everybody. And I also found that, you know, for me, by making, you know, myself better, or, you know, it helps other people, you know, in the way. So I'm just so unbelievably proud of you, because it's so motivating to other people. One, you know, Megan said the other day, Kanye haters make me famous. I just think that, you know, I got no time for most people who say anything or act any way or do anything. You have to realize the one thing that my old birth father said to me that I remember, which is incredible. One of the few things I remember that he said to me was check the source. Just check the source of where things are coming from. And sometimes the source is always out of fear and it's out of insecurity. And it's so ridiculous because it has nothing to do with you and everything to do with them. But what I love is that it gets people to do things that actually benefit themselves. So I'm so proud of you, and it's so motivating to me and every single other person, because you're beautiful, and you're just the fact of working on yourself is such an important thing, not just for us, but you know, for everybody else, because it motivates people. Whether you know it or not, you're a mirror for everybody else. And the more, like, that's why I try to live my life a certain way, right? Because as hard as it is, and some people, you know, listen, when people, fear makes people do weird things, right? And people get scared of people when they're kind of like, they don't understand why is this person not on drugs? Why is this person not drinking every day? Why is this person not out partying and blowing their money and doing this and being this way and being that way? It's fearful for people. So because of that, they start to kind of like, you know, they start to hate because they get nervous. So I don't prescribe to that. We don't prescribe to that at Go Get It, and I surely don't. So you know, one thing you'll always know is I got your back. So
forget about it. Thank you.
You know.
Thank you.
What's your question, Heather? What do you got?
So in the 7 years that you were on Sons.
Yeah.
Any good cast or crew stories that really inspired how you changed your viewpoint on life?
Yeah, I mean, 100%. I mean, you got to understand, we have a pretty amazing group, you know, of people over there, or should I say we had. I mean, we still have. We're all still, you know, homies, and we all still hang, and we all still do our thing. Is everybody in their way has had something. You know, and something that motivated somebody else to something else. You know, Kurt obviously changed my life in many ways. And you know, Katie is the greatest. Tig, you know, Kim and I are, you know, best friends. And, you know, and each one of them has, you know, challenged me in one way or another, whether that be to be better at what I do as my job or to work harder, you know, some things that Kurt has given me and certain examples that people have set in their own life. For me, it was just kind of, if I had to sum it all up, it would be the experience in general. I will be indebted to Sons of Anarchy for the rest of my life, no matter what I do. You know, whether it be these two movies that are coming up, another show right away, you know, whatever it is, my entire life changed during Sons of Anarchy. I was someone else when that show started. And then I became someone else, you know, around season 3. And the reason was, is because of things like you guys all talk about. Things like Phil. Things like you. You know, things that people talk about that, you know, that I decided, like, what is going on here? I don't know how much time I have left. You know, time is created by people. I don't know how much longer I'm going to be here. You know, I was like, what am I doing? I want to remember this. I want to be around. I want to make a difference. And I have a chance. So it was just the whole thing in general. In general, the whole thing. The whole experience. And I don't think there's any mistakes. I think everything happens for a reason. Even the really bad things that have happened to me. Because when they happened, they were really bad. And it made me... I'm sitting here talking to you guys, you know, and that's all I can ask for, you know. So thank you so much. Keep kicking ass. What went on with your foot? Metatarsal? What's going on? I have major foot injuries. What do you got going on?
It's a stress reaction, which is just a step closer to a fracture. Yes. And so I was doing a lot of boot camp exercises just on my arms and legs and upper body for like a full month and a half, and it was miserable, but I kept at it.
Yeah, I know all about it. So yeah, just trigger point therapy. Look it up. It saved my life.
Okay.
you're it's a little, just buy a lacrosse ball and your life will be saved. Thank you so much. Barb, what's up? What are you doing over there?
Hi.
How are you?
How you doing? I'm good.
What are you doing? What's going on? What's happening over there, Barb?
My dog's making me a little crazy.
That's because you're in New Jersey.
He was listening to you for a while. He was sitting here watching, listening, and then he got a little nuts.
Yeah, he got tired. So, he's coming here any second, and I'm done. So tell everybody, Barb. Tell everybody what you did and what's going on for the Gratitude Challenge and what's happening in Jersey, and what are you doing?
Well, in Jersey, it's freezing. But I, like Phil, I started out bad addiction, you know, for a long, long time. And when I lost everything, the only thing I had left was my dog. So when I, you know, picked myself back up and got everything back together, I decided to go from drugs to dogs. And a friend of mine and I started a nonprofit that offers veterinary assistance to low-income families who can't get their dogs or cats up to date on vaccines, get them spayed and neutered, you know, life-saving surgeries that they can't afford and would otherwise have to surrender them to a shelter or euthanize them. We step in and help them pay for it through 100% donations. We do fundraisers, we do events, we do bake sales, we do auctions, we do, you know, anything we can to raise money and help families not lose their beloved animals. And, you know, I'm very involved with my local shelter and pit bull rescues and promoting positive pit bull awareness. I have 3 rescued pit bulls. You know, anything I can do to...
What are those 3 pit bulls' names?
Savannah, Ellie Mae, and my new one, Blake, who I got a couple days ago.
Yeah, that's great. Sounds like a banker. And he's a pit bull.
But you know, every day paying it forward for those with no voice.
That's exactly it, and that's what I was going to say. You know, obviously, in today, you know, today's society, it's hard enough for most people, you know, without having health insurance and health care, and you know, sometimes we take ourselves to a limit of not being able to take care of ourselves. But at least we can, like, you know, talk to somebody about it or go get something. And you know what, I've always been, since I was a little kid, you know, trying to step up for anybody that doesn't have a voice. That started with, you know, whether it be somebody getting bullied at school down to, you know, it obviously eventually animals who, you know, just can't speak, even though I'm pretty sure my dogs are talking to me on a regular basis.
Mine understand every single thing I said.
These guys have they tell me everything. They know exactly what's going on. Rocco's looking at me right now and he's like, you need to take care of and take me out because I'm over this. So the thing is the reason why I think that's so important, especially for pits, which, you know, I've also had my whole life, is there's a certain connotation, there's a certain kind of thing, and that if people aren't sticking up for them, if we're not doing something, then nobody's going to. And as we get more in a have and a have-not society, mm-hmm. rich and poor, we start to get that gap where people, what's the first things that go? You know, maybe I'm not going to feed my dog today, or maybe I'm not going to take my dog to the vet. So look at this guy. Who's that?
Yeah, this is Blake. This is Blake.
He's my
little snorter. Oh. He's awesome.
He is awesome. Look at that head.
Yeah, he's a big blockhead. But I absolutely agree.
Look at that. That looks like Kim Coates' head. That is incredible. I just appreciate it so much. You know, obviously you're close to me in Jersey. We know the connotation of the pit bull in New York and New Jersey from a lot of, you know, a lot of thugged out people try to make it a certain way. So I thank you so much, and I'm constantly motivated by what you're doing, and congratulations too on kicking ass in your own life. That's super important. What's up? Tell me a question.
So Blake wants me to ask you, because my only question was the tattoo, which you're about to tell us. So that was my question.
You didn't hear it on the last one?
No, see, I didn't. So, and I made sure none of these guys told me before you got on here, but I had 6 people send me messages. That was all they wanted to know. So instead, we have a challenge for you. We want you to come to New Jersey, or we'll come to New York, to do a charity photo shoot to promote positive awareness for pit bulls. That would be awesome.
You send the information over, and you're not that far from me. And
like a little over an hour.
Send it over, and I will, you know, in my, I'm obviously, thank God, I'm to start off, well, not even that, you know, we're rolling right into these two movies in a row, which I'm really excited about, and be playing completely different human beings, which is going to be really nice. It's good to get away from myself sometimes. But yeah, you know, you know me, anything to do with dogs, and plus, you know, I do all my campaigns for the Humane Society, so I have, we're doing stuff all the time, so, you know, send me the info, let me know.
I will, thank you, I will, awesome. That's awesome.
If you guys didn't hear it before, I think everybody pretty much on this call might have heard, you know, the 122780, which I thought was, you know, it's funny, and all the people guessing from the beginning, nobody really guessed what it was. Everybody had their own theories, and you know, when I said what it was really cool to see people's reaction online. 122780, like we said, and I'll say it again, it was just something where after Chibs basically told, you know, Juice that this was it, you know, take the gun, stick it in your own mouth, you're not getting back in this club, it's over with. And at that point, Juice was, you know, trying to hide. He had his hair growing out. He was wearing the hats, and he was kind of trying to hide out until maybe he could reach Chibs and get back in. And that obviously didn't happen. And in that, he decided to make this decision to, you know, completely shave his head and not care about anything anymore. And he wasn't going to try to hide. And he wasn't, and even though Gemma and Unser and Wendy were hiding him, he had no interest in it because he just didn't care anymore. He didn't care if he lived. He didn't care if he died. He didn't care if he had to kill anybody. He didn't care about anything. So in doing that, the head was shaved, and you saw a tattoo that had been under his mohawk forever, because ever since we've known Juice, he's had the mohawk. And the story goes that Jax, you know, recruited Juice to come into the club because of his hacking, because of this, and Jax was kind of taking these young guys into the new age of it all. So we never really saw what was under there. And the reason we never saw what was under there is because he was hiding something that was under there, because he didn't want to have to deal with the questions of what it was. And what it was ultimately something that kind of spawned, you know, and spurred Juice's whole activity as a human being, which was that date. And that date, 12/27/80, which is the 2 days after Christmas in 1980, which is when his father left him. And when his father left him, that's the day that motivated him for everything in his life. It motivated him constantly because he thought about that day all the time. And when season 4 came and Eli Roosevelt mentioned his father, it brought up everything again. And that's where the, you know, that kind of downfall of Juice came. There wasn't the diaper guy. There wasn't the guy sticking the finger in the Irish guy's ass anymore and making jokes. And there wasn't that guy anymore. It became a different guy. And that started in 1227, December 27, 1980, when that's when his father had left him. So that's what the date meant, and it was a really cool formation of it when we decided to shave the head that something was going to be under there. It's actually Tracy, the makeup artist, his birthday is 1227. If you ask anybody, she's obviously 20 years old, so it's not 1980. That's kind of where it came from, and just Kurt and I talking about it, and I really thought it was really cool that after, you know, what happened to Juice, that they came down and kind of focused on that part of his head for a second, and it left everybody kind of in that lost moment of what do the numbers mean? That's what it was, and it kind of just was that fire underneath him forever, but something that once he knew he got into the club and what the rules were, he couldn't explain. So that was that, and poor little Juice. But, you know, it's funny that, you know, it's so funny. Everybody always says poor little Juice, and people get so sad for him and, you know, and all this. But at the end of the day, it was really cool to see every fan's reaction to Juice at the end, because he stood there at the end and still defended every single person and still wanted the club to be okay. And if it meant his own life, it meant his old life, his own life. And I thought that was really cool. So thanks so much, Barb. You guys are amazing. I'm constantly motivated by you and everybody else. I can't wait to send you some cool stuff. I'll send a little note of what everything is when you get it. I have, like, you know, obviously there's really cool things. I'm not going to say it and make everybody else kind of jealous who's watching this thing, but there's really cool things that I've, you know, totally, like, glommed and taken from the show over the years that I'm going to be sending you guys. So, you know, so thank you so much for everything you do, and I'll see you all on Go Get It Life on the blogs and all that, and I'm sure we'll be doing this again because we're not going to stop doing this. So thank you all. Barb, Heather, Keely, Jackie, my man Phil, hanging out with Gravino, you're in trouble. Tell everybody you guys are the best, and enjoy your day. Happy New Year, I guess we could still say that for a couple more days. Take it easy.